Good evening, all Atmas. Today we are going to see under Bagavad Gita, Gnana Yagna. The chapter 2, Communion Through Knowledge. This is a very important chapter, that's why each and every sloka has got a great significance on our day-to-day life. For a samsaric life, one has got, because we, as a people in the samsaric life, we are like karma yogis. We have to, in order to lead life successfully, fulfill all our duties, please all our karmas to attain moksha. That is the role of a karma yogi. Should do all the works without attachment. Then only each and every duty can be fulfilled successfully. Otherwise, if the attachment comes naturally, a karma will add to that. So that's why being a karma yogi is very difficult. A sannyasi has nothing. He gives everything, renounces everything, and goes and sit in the mountain or forest. He has no commitments for that. But for him, only think of God. Because many people, if you can come across people who are taken the sannyasa who is sitting in Tirunamalai or Kasi or mainly that what you call Agoris and all. They always 24 hours they are not doing penance or meditation. They used to have ganja, they used to have smoking, put vibhuti and chant for Shiva for some time and then roaming in the streets of Kasi and these things. So real renunciation means doing penance on God and realizing. But thing is, one who has no duty, a sannyasi has no other duty, but actual sannyasi who was in the path of renunciation are very limited. The so-called sannyasis, because once I went to Tirunamalai on Girivalam, at that time I see a lot of sannyasis sitting on the Girivalam asking for alms. So I put 10 rupees, I gave 10 rupees and asked 3 or 4 people to share it. And then just went side and saw what they are doing. They are fighting. He has given to me. Why I have to give it to you? I want this money. So a sannyasi who has renounced, there is no need for him to have money at all. They are fighting with each other. He has asked to share and you are keeping everything with you. All the 4 people. Because sannyasa is real sannyasi are very limited. But a person in the family life and to carry on all the duties perfectly without attachment is very difficult. And once who does this, they are called karma yogis. So each and every person who is carrying on our day-to-day duties by remaining in the family life, they are karma yogis. But when they become karma yogi, only when they do the duties with wholeheartedly, full dedication, involvement, devotion, self-determination, self-confidence, peace, perseverance, generosity, kindness, forgiveness. All these qualities you should possess without attachment, without desire, without greed, without avarice, without anger, without jealousy, without vengeance attitude, without the thought of pulling others' legs and to go up in the hierarchy of your management and the official life. This kind of thought should not be negative, rajasic and tamasic guna should be there, only positive, divine, sattvic guna should be there. And one who has pure having sattvic and divine gunas and one who has eradicated this rajasic and tamasic guna, they are called to be the real karma yogis. And here, Lord Sri Krishna tells to Arjuna to be a real karma yogi. When he gives Astasastra, he says, his turbulent sense draw away. That's what he says. The turbulent sense do violently draw away the mind of even a discerning person who is earnestly striving in the spiritual path. Pandavas, they follow the spiritual path. They surrender to Lord Krishna and do all these things. But at the same time, their love and affection to others, everybody, make them. So Krishna sees, Arjuna sees Bhishma, Drona. He had so much adoration for them. And now they are standing against them, against him, and he has to fight against them. By eye against them and kill them. What is that? So this attachment to the Bhishma, his grandfather, Drona, his teacher, has made him to get, made his mind turbulently, his senses carried away because of attachment to the body, to the relationship. So whatsoever relationship is there, we have to see them only as Atma. And as Atma, you have got only duty to do your duty, and as they are also Atma, they have got duty and which they are performing. And both of them are doing, as Atma, they are doing their duty. Just think in that point of view. Don't go, because at this juncture the fight is the destiny created by me. You are in the war field, but this is only a drama which I created for you. I am the story screenplay director, and you are playing the role which I have made you to play. I am giving this direction, you fight with him, and you have to fight. See, all the time in our life, we have to see our play, what we are doing, the roles, as a character. And this character is designed by God, and we are doing that role. So, in the particular scene, you have to show anger on the other person. He says, you show anger on that person, you show that anger. But that actor, what he is doing anger, actually he is only pretending, he is doing that acting. So that's why he is not getting affected by that anger. Because he is not, because he is doing only acting. This should be the attitude what God expects from us. Each and every person are doing the role. I am fixed the role. Bhishma has been given that role, you have been given that role. Instead of thinking Bhishma, now there you think Mukesh Khanna and here Arjun. So they are playing their characters. So that character they are doing perfectly, that's all. So you do your character perfectly. If you want to show anger, but show that anger in a pretended way. Don't make your mind to get really turbulent, really perturbed. No. Don't have any attachment. Do your duty. He wants you to play the character what he has given to, that's all. And totally follow him. Just follow him. What is given? Director is there. He is the story screenplayer. He returns the dialogues. He gives to you. God gives dialogues only what is divine to you, not devilish to you. So you have to just follow his instruction, do the duty and offer it to everything. Because he is the, when you do your duty perfectly according to his instruction, then automatically he will pay you the fee. What is that? Bhukti, that is the thing. So that's why you should not allow the turbulence to drive even a discerning person in a spiritual path. Having controlled them all, one should become entirely devoted to him. So having control, how we can able to control? When you bring these five senses, that's why I always keep in mind the Bagavad Gita, that picture. The chariot where inside Arjuna is sitting, Krishna is sitting in the charioteer seat. That horses, five horses, and the wheels, the wheel of the chariot. What it represents, I already told. Arjuna is Jivatma, Krishna is Paramatma, the five horses are five senses, the wheels are the Buddhi, and it is being kept under the divine consciousness of Bhagavan Krishna, and the Atma consciousness Arjuna. And the body is the chariot, and the wheels are the life cycle. And it is going in the Kurukshetra war. War is nothing but our life. Life is a war. Where all the people who are standing there are all relatives. So they are aiming the aranas. This is a simple thing. He is giving direction. Just surrender to him. That's why he says, entirely devoted to him. You totally surrender to me. I take you, I guide you. One whose senses are under control, his wisdom is firmly set. When you surrender to him, he will take the control of the five senses. And he holds it. You totally surrender to him. That's why you say, when you totally surrender to him, he will give the correct instruction to you. In the depth of the silence inside you, you hear the voice of God. That is the wording. Always keep it in mind, keep it in right on the road, on your wall. In the depth of the silence inside you, you hear the voice of God. So go inside. Whenever you get mind get perturbed, turbulent, go inside and surrender to him. God, please show me the way. I totally surrender to you. Please give me the first to overcome this turbulence and give me the solution for this particular problem. So most of the problems are created by myself, by my own ignorance. And first I have to go to the root of the cause for ignorance and then eradicate it. See, both husband and wife are educated and employed. Both are earning. And one small word told by husband, immediately her ego evokes and her senses become very turbulent and she immediately reflects back. and both gets turbulent. In the process, he beats her. Immediately she gets her ego evokes, and immediately she go and make a complaint to the police of her domestic violence actor. Immediately this man was called, and he was police arrested him. So what happened? The relationship spoiled. If you broke the glass, it cannot be joined. Relationship spoiled. For only a small word has led to the extent of arresting the man. So immediately. So how normally what the police people, they call the people and do reconciliation. So what is the cause? Okay, the arrest is, though the act provides for arresting the person who has committed the domestic violence, they will not do that. They will not put FIR immediately. They call them and make them reconcile. Why this problem? This family, every problem. We also police people, we also have families, we also have the problems. So they normally sit and make them to reconcile and send. At that time, see, one thing is, one who goes to the root, so with the both husband and wife, why this has happened? Go to the root. A small word, but that word, why he has said? Because she has got an increment and she is now earning more than him. So he felt a complexity has developed. That has led to his showing a negative vibration. And she got, since now she got more money than him, now she got a superiority over him. Her attitude changed suddenly. So this has made them to differences in their psychological factors that has put a barrier before them. So they ask them to, so you are both husband and wife. Only when you both live harmoniously, you can, your children are dependent on you, their future you have to see. All these things, they give a, so they go to the root, okay. See, both husband and wife like Ardhanarishvara. That's why God has shown you Ardhanarishvara. There is no Shakti ille, Shivam ille, Shivam ille Shakti. Shakti means lady, Shiva means gents. Husband and wife both when they are together, then only there is a family. So, if the family should be happy and a harmony means they should, each one should understand each other, one another. So both of them should be in the Atma-Atma consciousness, not an ego-ego consciousness. When you are an ego-ego consciousness, they both will repulse. Atma-Atma consciousness stage you have to come, whereby you understand, each one understands the each other's feelings and each other's sentiments. Each other's weakness, one able to understand and overcome it. Then only the real love and affection will be there. So, this understanding comes when you want to go to Atma consciousness or Divine consciousness. When the other person is ego consciousness, I go to Divine consciousness. Then, when the other person shouts, when I remain calm, the shout comes down. Not that I am succumbing or I am showing, I am becoming slave to, no. At that moment, once you have to understand the situation, if sound is there, then the opposite to sound is silence. Be there. That should be the attitude one should develop. When that comes, there will be harmony. For each sound, for one sound, there is a big sound, the sound's vibration, it becomes more vibrant and there will be negative energy flowing, resulting in sound vibrations will result in physical vibrations hitting each other and ultimately leads to, if both of them are male people are shouting each other, ultimately they leads to take something in the hand and immediately slash it. That will be a knife which slashes and murders. So that kind of turbulence of senses make a man to go to any extent without his knowledge. So everything happens without one's knowledge. They have to take their mind, they have to surrender, go deep and analyze the root cause. Go to the bottom, surrender to him, he will show the way. So you say, you should entirely devote to him. Any situation that comes, go and surrender to him and take his guidance. Then only the senses will come under control. Then only your wisdom is perfect. So if you take any decision in haste, under tension, the decision will not be perfect and you face failure. So whenever you take any decision, you remain calm, go deep into it, surrender to him. Normally when you go inside, deep inside, I told you earlier, first you hear the voice of ego. Ego's voice will always be peripheral in thought. When he hit you immediately, you go inside, what to do? Okay, you hit him. That is vayasa of ego. So there is no hitting, there will not be any solution. The fight will further proceed. Go deep inside, surrender to him. He says, no, why he has hit? What is the mistake you have committed? Okay, that makes you to do antaratma. Antaratma makes you to do atma vicharana. Then you take a decision. Yes, I should not get hit. If you have committed a mistake, because of which he hit you, then you say, sorry, it's my mistake. Immediately he comes down. He immediately becomes a friend to you. Once who is an enemy, when you understand and surrender, immediately you become a friend. That's the thing. That's the attitude one has to develop. Only when you develop the divine consciousness. The other man is having a devilish consciousness. You imbibe the devilish, divine consciousness. Then that person also becomes divine. That is the way you have to change the person's attitude by your own thing. Only that happens when you go and surrender to him and seek guidance him for each and every moment of our life. That is the thing. The next loka is, one who dwells longingly on sense objects, an inclination towards them is generated. This inclination develops into desire, and desire begets anger. Anger generates delusion. Delusion results in loss of memory. Loss of memory brings about destruction of discriminative intelligence, and loss of discriminative intelligence spells ruin to a man. It's a very, very important shloka, what Krishna is practically applicable to our life. When one who dwells longingly on sense objects, if you your mind is in a sensual conscious mind and sees something and is continuously seeing it, what happens? An inclination towards them is generated. You want to somehow or other acquire it. This inclination develops into a desire. So you get a desire to acquire it. And desire begets anger. Suppose you didn't have the enough resources to fulfill the desires, you get immediately anger. Anger generates delusion. Delusion means what? When you get anger, the mind gets agitated. Delusion results in loss of memory. So at that time, when I take any decision, when you do any act, you lose. What is that you are doing, he doesn't know. In a spur of a moment, when the anger comes, what you are doing, he doesn't know. Loss of memory brings about destruction of discriminative intelligence. Loss of memory, destruction of discriminative intelligence means what you are doing, whether it's right or not, you are not able to think. Immediately you do it at a spur of a moment. And loss of discriminative intelligence spells ruin to a man. That you have done the mistake, done in a spur of a moment, that leads to murder. It spells ruin to a man. A calm person who got excited by a turbulent act, evoked by the other person, he has gone to the extent of taking something in a spur of a moment in the hand and hit the person. And the something what he is having in his hand also he doesn't know. And he hit it, and it is nothing, that what is done in there, the knife, it cut his, he just pierced it in the stomach and the pan fell immediately. He took a big iron rod and hit on his face immediately. It struck him and he fell on the spot. So in the spur of a moment, one thing happens, it's because anger doesn't know what. Here, you had a desire to acquire that property, because we see a lot of property problems. And the other person is grabbing you, that you want to take the entire jiva. So in that process, what happens? Those who are putting him in obstruction to you, immediately you get anger on him. And the spur of a moment, that anger is a delusion of memory, delusion, and desire begets anger, anger generates delusion, and delusion results in loss of memory. So when you get deluded, that anger makes you, what you are doing, he doesn't know. I want this, he is standing as an obstruction to me. So the mind begins to think how to acquire it. So it takes all the negative path. Delusion means at that time, you lose loss of memory. Loss of memory means what you are doing, he doesn't know at that time. Loss of memory brings about destruction of discriminative intelligence. Somehow or other you want to acquire it. So whether it is right or not, you won't think immediately. And loss of discrimination spells ruin to man. So in the spur of a moment, you plan to eradicate that person. Such is the stage of destructive intelligence. So for all these things, what is the cause? Is your sense, the sensual consciousness, how it takes to the sense attraction to the sense object, the results in desire, desire results in loss of memory, loss of discrimination, destruction of discriminated intelligence, that spills through into man. So one should know all these things. So to overcome these things, what is needed? A man of disciplined mind who has his sense under control and who has neither attraction nor aversion for sense objects, attain tranquility, though he may be moving amidst objects of senses. Then all one's sorrows comes to an end and the intellect of such person becomes steady. So, in order to overcome this turbulent senses, in order to overcome the mind getting attracted by the senses, getting attracted by the desires which leads to loss of discriminated intelligence, so one has to keep the mind in a disciplined way. So disciplined way means going inside and seeking his surrender to him and seeking his guidance. Then the mind gets controlled by him. And who has neither attraction for or aversion for sense objects. So in such, when you go inside at that time, you will see your mind only focus on duties. It neither get attracted nor get averse to the events what is happening. If something bad happens, release of bad karma. Something good happens, release of good karma. That is the thing. When that thought comes, there won't be any aversion or attraction. And mind attains tranquility, come to the stage of sita prajna. Though he may be moving amidst objects of the senses, though he will be doing all the acts. On the day I told about the farmer, he will do everything, whatever be the ups and downs, loss of cow, gain of cow, son getting met with the accident, whatever be the situation, he remains cool and tranquil. Then all one's sorrows comes to an end and the intellect of such person becomes steady. So, all sorrows comes to an end because you don't have any sorrow. Because anything bad happens, leads to bad karma. Anything good happens, leads to good. Then what is the necessity for me to get sorrow? My mind won't go to Dhamasika Rajasikuna. And the intellect of such person becomes steady. So, at that time, the buddhi will remain calm at all times. So, we have to surrender to him, seek his blessing, keep the senses under control, to keep the buddhi in a state of tranquility so that it won't get excited or dejected. There won't be sorrows, anything. One can able to do the duties perfectly without any turbulence of their senses, without any desires, so that they can carry on the duties perfectly without attachment, fulfill their duties successfully and lead a prosperous, peaceful life, for which only the Bhagavad Gita has given this sloka. One should follow this and see achieve success and peace in their life. Thank you.